In general, we can categorize this criticism under two titles. The first is political criticism. When we analyze the literature towards Gülen on his ideas and his performance in terms of dialogue, political criticism argues that this is a kind of tactical move to make the Christians and other peoples happy because having a kind of agenda. The second criticism is, I think, more critical. It's a theoretical criticism, which says that Gülen's ideas are not being proper for being Islamic. Also, this criticism can be analyzed under two titles. The first mode reminds that there are some other problems within the Islamic Ummah in the Middle East, in Africa, that one should first focus on them before making a dialogue with Christians or other peoples. But the topic that I will focus on is the second mode, which says that, as I have referred before, that there's a kind of criticism which reminds that Gülen is not following the traditional Islamic understanding on dialogue. So this is quite un-Islamic. First of all, I should say that criticism is a very normal aspect of Islamic thought, Islamic philosophy. If you make a short perusal of previous debates, you will see more harsh criticism, not only towards Gülen, but also Beyruni, Ebu Hanife. Even Ebu Hanife is famous for the criticism he faced from his own disciples, his own students. So it is quite normal. In the same way, on the issue of dialogue, I think Gülen, on the one hand, is representing a continuation of these traditional understanding of Islam, but on the other hand, there is, in the case of Gülen, we should talk about an evolution of Islamic thought. And in analyzing this connection with the legacy, I will bring a comparative reading of Al-Ghazali's quite famous but neglected book, Faisal al-Tafriqa, which means that in this book, in 14th century, Abu Hamid al-Ghazali tried to focus on a very serious problem, how to deal with the other people from different religions, and more important is what is the Islamic criterion of dealing with those people in terms of faith, in terms of tactics, so on and so forth. The reason why I choose al-Ghazali is quite clear, because Ghazali, to use or to borrow a concept from Christian theology, I think is a canonic text of Islam. There is no debate on Abu Hamid al-Ghazali. There are different debates on different scholars, but to a large extent, from Far East to the Middle East, Abu Hamid al-Ghazali even is championed in the Shia Islamic tradition. First of all, I should here remind how Gülen is connected to Islamic production of knowledge. There are several names that I should remind here. First of all, for example, Imam Sirhindi in India, Shah Veliullah Dahlevi, Mevlana Rumi previously underlined, and also Alvarlı Lütfi, Molla Halil Vehbi Efendi, Sırrı Efendi, Şahabettin Efendi, Sadi Efendi. These names are critical that shaped Gülen's informal education in the past. So on the one hand, yeah, Gülen is representing this historical continuity. But on the other hand, there is a new contribution to contemporary Islamic thought. In his book, İman Esasların Etrafında, Fethullah Gülen has argued that the collapse of Islamic civilization is mainly about the collapse of renewal tradition, what is called tejdid tradition in Islam. So I think while reading Gülen, we shouldn't forget that there is a renewal aspect which might trigger some kind of criticism from different perspectives. The second point is, I should refer, just like before my reading, comparative reading with Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, I think this is quite critical. Dialogue or this kind of activities in Gülen should be seen as part of faith. In his quite interesting book, Enes Ergene, I think, make a summary of this debate. According to this book, Gülen is quoted as himself underlines that faith connects man with all other living and non-living in the universe. So dialogue is about this responsibility and necessity that is originating from one's faith. So there is a universal reality including faith, and part of that Muslims should face this responsibility of making a step forward in dialogue. So what is this? According to Gülen, quoting, man has a responsibility to show compassion to all living beings as a requirement of being human. So as Sarı Toprak and Griffith also in their article reminded before, Examining Gulen's teaching on interreligious dialogue, one notices in the first place that he traces the idea back to basic Islamic dams. So on this point, dialogue in Gulen is a, let's say, reformulation of the tradition in Islamic teachings. So here, it is attached very strictly to the basic Islamic sources to affirm this point. Again, let me quote Gulen on this point. Interfaith dialogue is a must today, and the first step in establishing it is forgetting the past, ignoring polemical arguments. I believe that the idea of polemical arguments here do refer to theological arguments, not political arguments only. And also, in an article authored by Gulen, the title of article is quite interesting, the necessity of interfaith dialogue, we understand from this article that dialogue will be the natural result of the practice of Islamic ethics. Ethics is, I think, also important here. I mean, the reference is not to Islamic philosophy or Islamic fiqh. It is ethic, morality. We have a responsibility. So it comes from more about this aspect. So after this brief introduction that I have tried to show how in Gulen dialogue is attached to Islamic understanding of ethics, let me find out some common points between Al-Ghazali and Fethullah Gulen. First of all, the first point, timing. In this book, Faisal al-Tafriqa, the third part is devoted to these debates now we are talking. So the ideas now we are facing are not new. Even in 14th century, the Islamic scholars such as Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, even facing the Mongol invasion, Imam Zahabi, also Ibn Taymiyyah, they did write serious things to talk about these kind of critical questions. In this book, first of all, the first point, I think, which connects Gulen to Abu Hamid al-Ghazali is both scholars reject monopoly on truth. This is a common point first I should refer. Al-Ghazali did write as follows. If he claims, any person, that the definition of unbelief, kufr, is that which contradicts the Ash'arite school or Mu'tazilite school or the Hanbalite school, referring some schools in Islamic fiqh, or any other school, then know that he is a glibble dim witted fellow who is stifled by his enslavement to blind following. In fact, he is ignorant than the blind. So, according to Ghazali, a person who claims monopoly over truth in regard to some established schools, such as Hanbalite or Mu'tazilite, is not proper according to Islamic perspective. Then Ghazali asks this question or reminds this point. Ask him how he come to enjoy this monopoly over truth. What is the source of this monopolistic attitude? How come a person, a Muslim, can claim monopoly over a truth? In explaining this statement, also Ghazali made a very interesting pedagogical tactic. For example, he says that he reminds the controversy over a theological problem between Al-Baqilani, a quite famous scholar of that time, and the Ash'arite school. Ghazali says that none of them can claim the monopoly on truth. This monopoly on truth, this is important because Ghazali, while explaining the impossibility of monopoly on truth, refers to famous names, Al-Baqilani, the great scholar, and trying to say that even for such people, it is not proper to claim such things. And also he asks, if on the other hand, it is permissible for Al-Baqilani to go against the Ash'arite school, why should this be denied to others? If Baqilani can criticize the Ash'arite school, why another scholar cannot do that? Why is the difference between Al-Baqilani or Kalanisi or others? I think this is something also that attaches Al-Ghazali to Gulen. Gulen has very similar ideas on that. For instance, while analyzing the intellectual legacy of Said Nursi, Gulen writes, Nursi made use of previous Islamic scholars. However, he did not follow them in every issue. So there is a continuity, but on the other hand, there is a contribution. So this is also which that is observed in the case of Nursi by Fethullah Gulen. And also, the second point about this monopoly of truth, let me summarize a quite long debate, but very shortly. Al-Ghazali, in this specific book, analyzes the idea of truth. What is truth? And he presents several categories of truth. Very shortly, for example, zati, hissi, hayali, which means ontological, sensory, so on and so forth. So Ghazali reminds that there are different understanding of truth. So the question is, which perspective from a person is analyzed at. This debate is per se repeated by Gülen in his famous introduction to the book İlim ve Bilim. I don't know how to translate, but science and ilim in Arabic. Knowledge maybe, yeah, that's the point. And very, very similar to Ghazali and also very similar to Popper, in this introduction, Gülen questions the idea of scientific monopoly, the risk of founding scientific monopoly. Here, in this introduction, after a comparative study of Islamic Irfan and science, Gülen reminds that, just like Popper and Al-Ghazali, scientific arguments may change in due course for various methodological reasons. And he reminds farklı mülahazalar, which can be translated in Turkish, different reasoning. The second point I want to emphasize in terms of comparison to represent, to symbolize continuity, yeah, just 5 minutes, both scholars are very cautious on speaking about fate. For instance, Al-Ghazali says several volumes will not be enough to cover all this. And according to Ghazali, a good Muslim should at least be kept his or her silence over fate against criticizing other situation in regard to God. So Ghazali says that, okay, several volumes will not be enough. This is very, very, very critical issue. And Al-Ghazali, as a great scholar, says, quite critical, as for the advice, it is that you restrain your tongue to the best your ability. Indeed, branding people unbelievers is a serious matter. Remaining silent, on the other hand, entails no responsibility at all. So this is also another fact. I mean, because as Gülen says, just like Ghazali, everything is secondary in terms of faith. One should, I think, be silent on this issue. There's a long debate, some other points maybe then my audience can read from my paper, but the last thing I should refer again in this book, in the end of the book, Ghazali also made an interesting debate about the status of Byzantine Rums and some non-Muslim Turks in Anatolia in 13th century. And in the end of third section of this book, Ghazali publicly writes, demonstrates that, I would say that, God willing, most of the Christians of Byzantium and Turks of this age will be covered by God's mercy. So, there are many other things that I can also criticize. All these facts demonstrate that the idea of dialogue that was formulated by Gülen, of course, there are some serious components that symbolize Gülen's original contribution to the contemporary Islamic philosophy, but on the other hand, is nothing but per se a continuation of Islamic philosophy, which traces back to Al-Ghazali, even a case. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Well, thank you very much. That's been a very nice overview through the whole panel of matters, philosophical and political over 14 centuries. Is Fethullah Gulen simply a traditional Orthodox thinker, or is, as Mr. Ali Bulac said, the most important contributor, most important Turkish export in terms of globalization of ideas today? Our panel members have been very disciplined, scholars young and old, very able scholars in keeping their time short, but that sacrifice is wasted unless we have a good conversation now. So I'm sure there's some questions. Do you have an opinion on whether Mr. Gulen is innovative or traditional? Do you have a question about globalization, the political context?
I'm wondering if, since some of the criticisms of the movement come from inside Turkey, from other Muslims, if that isn't a piece of evidence that Mr. Gulen's thought goes beyond traditional Muslim thinking.
First of all, I think, that's the fact. But there is a very funny point about the criticism towards Gülen, because there is a group in Turkey who criticize Gülen for going beyond tradition. So some other finding him, not satisfactory radicals. So it depends on political perspective. But there is a criticism, especially not only from Turkey, but some circles that criticize whether Gülen and his ideas on a spatial dialogue keeps track with the authentic Islamic tradition. So this is a fact. So in this paper, what I'm trying to find out or make this kind of connection. So in terms of political criticism, it's not a political criticism, but Islam, has a very complex history in Turkey since 10th century, so there are different understanding of Islam. Fethullah Gulen is a brilliant sample of Turkish Islam representing, but there are also different interpretations in Turkey which criticize him. Yeah, that's the point.